to get started. So we got a few more people trickling in. There's a few open seats in the front here and over on this side if you're looking for space. So welcome to Dev B212, Agile Software Development with Microsoft Visual Studio ALM. My name is Aaron Bjork, and I'm joined on stage by my colleague Peter Provost, and we're going to be your hosts for this session. I'm going to kind of do something a little different, a little backwards. Instead of telling you what we're going to talk about, I'm actually going to start by telling you what we're not going to talk about. So I want to give you a heads up on that. This isn't going to be a demo session. So if you've already been at the foundational session and the keynote this morning, you've seen some of the demos of the new things that are coming out in Visual Studio 2013 and Team Foundation Server 2013. And we've actually got three follow-up sessions later today and tomorrow where we're going to do deep dives really into developer productivity, agile planning, and source control. And I want to encourage you to go to those sessions. But as Peter and I were preparing, we realized that if we do a bunch of demos and then do a bunch of demos again, we're probably going to bore everybody to tears and end up demoing all the same stuff. So this session is really more of a practices session. We're going to talk about agile teams, we're going to talk about environments, and we want to share some of our experiences as program managers who work on the tools that you guys use every day, and a little bit about how we've evolved our own agile teams. So our agenda looks something like this. We're going to talk about fine-tuning your process and how you do that. We're going to talk about playing the same game across all the teams, dealing with debt, measuring the outcome that you want, and then the makings of what we consider a great product owner. And the backdrop for all of this is really the Visual Studio Agile transformation. So if you've kind of rewind a few years and say, how has our product changed? How have the developer division who's building this product sort of undergone their own Agile transformation? And Peter and I want to share some of those experiences. Sound good? So that's fair warning. If you're expecting a demo talk, you can get up and leave, and we won't be pissed. So. Before we do that, I want to give you a little bit of a quick bio on each of us. So I'll start with myself. I'm not going to read everything up there, but my name is Aaron Bjork. I'm a principal program manager at Microsoft. I've been at the company for around 11 years. Let's see. The kind of two interesting things really on this slide is when I'm not at work and writing code, I love to do two things. I love to play golf. Do we have any golfers in the audience? It's just a smattering. It's always my biggest regret. Everybody in our industry plays golf on the Xbox, but nobody really plays golf, so I struggled with that one.
It's not the same when you just swing free like this.
It's not the same, no. My other sort of passion is my wife and I recently purchased a small farm, so I now live on 15 acres, and I bought a tractor. So do we have any tractor owners out there? Yeah, fewer hands.
There are some.
There's a few, but come talk to me afterwards because I need all the help I can get. I'm way over my head on this. I'll tell you a quick story. I actually have three staples in my head, and that's because Saturday I was out working on the farm, and I had a little bit of a farm accident with some implements. So I thought I was going to have to call Peter and tell him he was going solo, but they stitched me up, and we made it. So if you see me bleeding, raise your hand and tell me. I will appreciate that. And I'll let Peter describe himself.
Yeah, so I've been at Microsoft for about 9 years and involved in the Agile community for more than 10 now. And I've been standing up here talking about Agile stuff since long before joining the Visual Studio team. And when I got the opportunity to join up 5 years ago to help actually effect a bit of an Agile transformation with inside Visual Studio, I was very excited. And so now here we are 5 years later, and Aaron and I have some great stories to share with you guys about that. Now, for me, if I was going to pick a couple of the interesting things for me, it's probably that in the last year I joined a rock and roll cover band. We think of it as the old man married 40-something pretending we're 20s band. But we play gigs and we get paid. It's really kind of cool. I'm surprised that people will pay us to do it, but we have a lot of fun. I've been a guitar player since I was a kid, and a buddy of mine calls me up and says, hey, we need a bass player. Do you know anybody? And I said, oh, I'll play bass. He said, oh, I didn't know you could play bass. Oh, sure, I can do that. Hung up the phone and said to my wife, honey, I need to go buy a bass and learn how to play it by Thursday. Well, here it is now, almost 8 months later, and I'm still in the band, so apparently it worked out. The other thing, I do karate with my son, Kenpo. Anybody here martial arts? Yeah? It's been a great thing for him, and I mostly got him involved in it for a little self-discipline stuff, and now it turns out I like it, I think, more than he does. But Yeah, Aaron and I, we're both in our out of our uniform, right, with pants and collared shirts on and stuff, but we're both pretty much jeans and t-shirts kind of guys all day. So we want to talk, we're going to kind of underpin this whole session with this idea of the transformation of the Visual Studio team. So Aaron and I both been involved in DevDiv and this transformation now for 5+ years. And so we were in this place, right, where we knew we needed to make some changes. We knew we needed to change the way the business thought about its work and thought about how they organized and planned and executed on that work. And we needed to move from this point A over here to this point B. And there were so many things to change, it was often hard to even think about what to focus on first. I want to just give you one little point to kind of give it some meat so you can see it. But then we're going to spend more time actually getting into a lot of the details and show you some of the specifics about how we did it and tools we used and how we used our own tools to get there. But this is kind of an interesting little way to look at one of the things that's changed about us. When we did Visual Studio, or this is Team Foundation Server 2008, the TFS team had an iteration length, a sprint length, of somewhere around 10 to 12 weeks long. That's pretty long. And I'm assuming that you guys have all either got some familiarity with Agile or have read enough to, let's say, be dangerous. Okay, so you know that's pretty long. So as we moved into 2010, the TFS team dropped back to a six-week iteration increment, which was a lot better for them, clearly. And then when we did 2012, they dropped back to a three-week increment. And I'm going to show you later how that compares to some of the other teams inside of Visual Studio and similar kinds of evolutions, because you know we're a big organization, and how we've chosen to handle that has been very interesting. But this has all been about kind of setting up that environment and setting it up so that the environment of the team enables us to make the change. Because in order for us to do the kind of agile transformation that we've been wanting to do, we have to establish that baseline environment to keep going.
So when we talk about environment, I like to contrast it with another word. And you can see that the other word up here that I've got is control. And why do I pick the word control and contrast it with environment? I think the reason I do that is because when we think about agile teams, and we think really about software teams, you can throw the word agile out if you want. But when you think about really good software teams, they operate in really good environments. And I think that our job as leaders, and I'm assuming most of you are leaders of some sort in your organizations, our job is to make sure that we're building healthy, awesome environments where team members want to come to work, where they have fun, where they enjoy writing code or testing code or writing specs. And I think that's our responsibility. But I think often we sort of get that wrong. And I'm not sure why that is. Sometimes I just think it's human nature. But I think we tend to emphasize control, and we emphasize what I call sort of managing agile teams. And I often give a talk similar to this that we title Unmanaging Agile Teams. And it's how do you get out of the way and stop sort of emphasizing control and instead start emphasizing the environment and start thinking about the environment and talking about the environment and making sure that your environment is healthy for your teams. So today's talk is really going to be a lot about that environment. And what we're going to do is share with you a set of experiences that we've been through ourselves, things that we think we've learned. We're going to be very transparent about things that have worked and things that haven't. We are not a perfect organization by any stretch of the imagination. I'm sure you know that and have seen evidence of that through the years. But I think we both Peter and I love sharing what we have learned along the way. And you know, just to give you a little idea about that too, since we skipped over it a little bit, Peter and I both work on the Visual Studio and Team Foundation Server products. We call that space together ALM, Application Lifecycle Management. My teams tend to focus on more the product owner role, more of the backlog management and things like that. Peter's teams tend to focus a little bit more on sort of the engineering aspects. So what's it actually like to write code inside the IDE and things like that. So that's where we're going to start.
So we're going to set you up here with a question to kind of keep in the back of your mind. And we're going to do this a few times with questions, but this is the question that kind of sits underneath the whole thing. And I want you to think about it as we're going through the rest of this talk. Do you focus and care about primarily that control, that constraint and management of your teams? Or are you primarily caring about the team's health, their environment, their success? Which one of those matters to you the most? Because we've struggled with this fight a lot as we've been going through this transformation. We came from one place and we've gone to another. I think you already know what our answer is, but it's how you answer this question. There's the instinctive reaction that you'll have the first time you start to think about it, and then if you actually potentially pay attention to what happens at work every day, you might suddenly find a slightly different answer.
All right, so where are we going to start? We're actually going to start at the end, and this might seem odd, but the first topic I want to talk about is actually retrospectives. And I'm sure you're familiar with what a retrospective is. A retrospective is a time of reflecting at the end of a milestone of some sort. And you talk about things that went well and things that went not so well, and you try to make changes, right? And the reason I like to start by talking about retrospectives is because retrospectives represent you're going to be changing, that you're constantly going to be looking at this, and you're constantly going to be paying attention and trying to improve your environment and improve your teams. And I want to tell you a little bit of a brief story that goes along with this. When we used to do retrospectives back in the day that Peter described here, back in TFS 2008 and the 2010 releases, we would often hold what I would describe as these big retrospectives at the end of milestones. Sometimes they would be at the end of maybe a 10 to 12 week milestone, sometimes maybe even at the end of the product cycle. And they were often all day type activities. We'd get the whole team together. We'd meet in a room. This might sound familiar. We'd hang a bunch of sheets up on the wall, and we'd split up into groups, and we'd have this all day process about asking what went well, what didn't go well. We'd then narrow those down into a bunch of things that we all agreed on, and we'd vote on them. We often put little dots up on the boards and, you know, identify the things that everybody agreed on. Then we would take some time, and we'd go off, and we'd sit in corners together, and we'd have open space sessions, and we would decide on things that we wanted to do better, and we would write a bunch of new lists, and we called that our retrospective.
It took all day.
It took all day, usually. And usually the team came out of it pretty pumped. They're like, wow, if we can do some of that stuff, we are going to be in better shape. It was great. And then, Peter, what did we usually do with those things?
You take those big pages down and you roll them up and you take them back to the office because we're going to use them again, except that somehow they're still sitting on my desk, rolled up just like they were 5 years ago. In fact, and I was telling Aaron that I actually wasn't kidding. I do have one of these sitting on top of my bookshelf rolled up in a bundle. And it never got looked at again. It went up on the bookshelf, and we kept doing things the way we had always been doing them. Maybe little tiny changes, but a little tiny change every 12 weeks is pretty slow.
Yeah, my point there is not to, you know, I think everybody's intention was good with those meetings, but they never really amounted to anything. And I think that at the heart of a retrospective is that you've got to do it often, and you've got to have a process that you follow that your team really buys into. And as we move to three-week milestones, we've really gotten to a place where all our teams hold their own retrospectives and actually participate in these. And they're not sort of management-led activities. They're team-led activities, which is really one of the real principles of Agile, which is self-organizing and self-managing teams. So I actually want to take this statement, which is, at regular intervals, the team reflects on how to become more effective, then tunes and adjusts its behavior accordingly. I want to break it down a little bit. The reason I have this statement up there is this is actually a statement that is from the back of the Agile Manifesto. I think we're all probably familiar with the Agile Manifesto at this point. It might be even cliche in some circles. But if you go to the 12 principles that are with it, this is the 12th principle. And I love it because the words are very meaningful. So first it says regular intervals. We're going to do this at a regular time. We're not going to do it when somebody decides it's a good idea, but we're going to do it regularly. And for our teams, we do this at the end of every sprint. We're going to reflect, and the team is actually going to reflect. So this isn't management reflecting for the team. This isn't management telling the team what they think they can do differently. This is the team actually looking inward and reflecting on its own about how to become more effective and then tuning and adjusting. And I love the words tune and adjust here because it does not say that we're going to become a different team. We're not going to throw out our entire methodology every sprint. We're not going to be Scrum one sprint, and then Kanban another sprint, and then who knows what the next. We're not going to change everything every time, but we're going to tune and adjust. We're going to look for those little things that we can change, and we're going to keep doing it over and over and over. And then the final one might be the most important. And the final one is that it says we're going to tune and adjust its behavior, the team's behavior. And I think one of the common traps that we fall into as software teams is we're great at pointing out everybody else's faults, but we're not really great at maybe finding our own faults. If any of you are married, you might relate to this at some level. It's easy to see the faults in your spouse. It's hard to see the faults internally that you have. But I think this is really important, because if you get this wrong and you start holding retrospectives that say, well, if management would do X, Y, and Z, and if this team would do that, then we'd be okay. I think you've got it backwards. There are variables here that you can't control. And for example, you know, we're standing in a room here, and there are variables that I can't control, and there are variables I can control. We can adjust the lights, we can rearrange the chairs, we could do things slightly differently. But I can't change the shape of this room right now, and I can't change the height of the ceiling. Those things are out of my control. And if I start focusing I see somebody looking at the ceiling, like, wait, maybe we could, actually. It's a convention center, you never know. These are sort of like transformer rooms. But if you start focusing on the wrong things, you get it backwards, and you end up with this victim mentality as a team. And your retrospectives start to become a negative impact on the team instead of a positive impact. So again, we're starting at the end, but I really wanted to highlight this to say, hold retrospectives and follow this process and make sure your teams are doing this, because as you're changing, I think you'll see more productive change as you move along.
The other thing Aaron is hinting at very strongly here, this the team is adjusting its own behavior. One of the things I saw on one of our teams when we were first starting this thing out was that the management and the leads would get together for a retrospective. And the team was just kind of continuing to do their thing. And as you can imagine, where that's going to take us is we end up having this almost dictatorial thing where the management and the leads would get together at those terribly long intervals, come up with a big list of all the things that they wanted to change, and then dictate it down to the teams. There was no self-adjustment, no self-alignment, right? The team has to have a certain sense of ownership over what it's choosing to do in order to be successful here, and in order to really tune their behavior for effectiveness, because they know what they need to do. Management's going to give them a whole bunch of other things, and we'll be talking about some more of those in just a few minutes.
All right, so what I leave you with is really, is your team regularly adjusting its behavior? And I'd leave you also with, are your teams empowered to adjust their own behavior? And do you let them adjust your own behavior? I think it's definitely something to think about. So we'll move on.
So this is one of those things that kind of has been becoming more and more dear to my heart as we've been going through the later stages of this transformation inside of developer division. I've been calling it play the same game, and really what I'm talking about there is the game, if you think of it from a sports metaphor, we talk about whether it's soccer or football or baseball, we've got the field and we've got the rules and people play certain positions, and you know everybody understands how those work, but still, when you go out to play the game, you do not play exactly the same game as everybody else, right? My team makes decisions about how to move the ball, how to pass, where people stand, how to move, how do they pair up. But the rules of the game and the structure of the game and the shape of the field, those things are defined. And so what I'm trying to get to here when we think about from a software development perspective is establishing enough of the ground rules that allow your teams to not have to think about that stuff. So this kind of gets to one of the challenges we face in our world of scale. How many of you guys are working in an environment where you're in, let's say, Enterprise Agile with multiple teams working on projects together? See, even more than 25%. That was really good. Right, so that's the same world we are in. Okay, I sit over top of four or five teams, Aaron, four or five. And if we look around at the other people who are at our same place, we got the same kind of numbers. We have 1,000 people working inside of developer division. So here's one way you could do it. Every team, you know, go read the Agile books and do what you want to do. And believe it or not, that's how we started. That's where we started back at the very beginning of all this. We let every team kind of do whatever they wanted. And this leads us to a really crazy place where we're all sort of doing this Agile thing, but we seem to be really having a hard time working together. And because we don't want to tell the teams how to do what they're doing, how to do their job. Let me give you some examples. And these are concrete, real things right from our land here. I was looking at the iteration length thing before, but I was only talking about TFS before. I want to kind of show you how we evolved this. If we go all the way back to the 2008 product time, the iteration lengths for each of these, and I kind of just divided us up arbitrarily into the VSTS product family, which back in the day, you know, was TMARC and team test and those things, and then has now become kind of ultimate and premium and the ALM side of the Visual Studio business. And then Team Foundation Server, and then kind of the rest of Visual Studio, because we do kind of have a bit of an organizational, it's not that we're organizationally defined that way, but it's that we tend to kind of make process decisions in similar pillars to this. So we had these really long chunk iterations. They were scary long from an Agile perspective. And as we started moving our way down, we started kind of adopting different lengths, and we were very autonomous, right? So the VSTS team quickly dropped to a very short iteration. TFS said, it's too short. We don't like, we can't do that. It's too short. How could you possibly get anything real done in that amount of time? So they went twice as long. And then much of the rest of Visual Studio was even twice as long as that. When we hit readying for the Visual Studio 2012 product cycle, so after shipping 2010, we then, those of us on the ALM side, which is VSTS and TFS, we said, no, we're gonna agree. We're just going to lock down here and agree on this. And the rest of Visual Studio shortened themselves down a bit, but still not quite. And now, as we're starting to build out the product that you guys are going to get in preview soon, we've all agreed. And it is now standard across all of developer division. And it's completely changed the way we talk to each other, right, Aaron?
Yeah, I think one of the real advantages that we've seen from this is that we've now got a common language across the entire division that we all use. And so I'll give you an example. We are right now in the third week of Sprint 49. And that's just, we give them numbers. We started at 1 a couple years ago, and we're now on 49. And every 3 weeks, we increment that number. But it creates a language where you can go to anybody in the division and say, you know, where are you at? And they say, well, you know, we think we're going to be done around Sprint 51. And that all means the same thing to everybody. Instead of them saying, well, we're going to be done by our M2, you know, exit milestone. And, okay, remind me again what that is and what date that is and what that means and how I should think about it. And what happened when we had those different languages is we had to have a lot more process. We had to have a lot more overhead, if you will, and management to try to make sense of all that. And it just creates overhead. It creates a lot of waste in the system.
I mean, I remember a point in time back over, there's no laser on this thing, bummer. Oh, there is. Back over here-ish time frame, when Aaron and I were working together on some feature work, and he was telling me something about what sprint they were going on. And it was like, you know, he said, yeah, well, you know, we'll finish that at the end of 26. And I'm like, 26 was last week. Oh, no, no, we're on 26 now, but then we're gonna make 27 longer so you guys will catch up. But then I think we'll end up falling behind again because ours are, we always were having to have these conversations of trying to figure out how to align our schedule. And so we spent huge amounts of time just talking about stupid stuff like that, instead of focusing our attention on what we needed to. Because this is one of those things that there is just no value at all in teams having autonomy here. It doesn't buy us anything. We should let our teams invest their brain power and their effort on what they're good at, which is building software features, not arguing over iteration length. To be honest, you can pick pretty much any length and it'll work. This is one thing we've certainly learned. We happen to have chosen 3 weeks. People like to ask the question, Aaron, you've always had a good answer for this.
Well, people ask us, they say, why 3 weeks? And I say, well, it's really just where we landed. We tried 4 weeks, and it felt too long. We tried 2 weeks, and it felt too quick. And 3 weeks is what worked for us. And it's funny, because I was at a conference earlier this year, and the guy giving the keynote was talking about Agile. And he said, you know, if there's anything I'll leave you with, it's 3 weeks is the worst iteration length for any team to have. You know, and I thought, oh, crap, you know, what are we doing? But I think that's part of it, is that I don't think there's a real science to this. It's a little bit more of an artwork. And you've got to understand, you guys know your teams, you know your business, you know your environment, and you probably know what's the right length, and you need to figure that out. Mm-hmm. But for us, 3 weeks has worked really well.
So the funny thing is, there's a little secret for you. My teams actually do 1 week. But every 3 weeks, they get together and agree to line up on their numbers. So we'll have 46.1, 46.2, 46.3, 47. But then we stay lined up, so it works. But the teams
actually... I don't have to understand it.
No, you don't. And it's an internal thing, right? My teams like to get together every Monday and plan out what they're going to do that week. And then they do it again the next Monday, and they do it again the next Monday. And every three of those, they deliver the sprint, and the sprint can then deliver up into upper branches or deployment and delivery, whatever it is that we need to have happen. Okay? There's another one of those interesting things where it's kind of one of those shape of the field, rules of the game things that we just, for some reason, took us forever to figure out. And it's area paths in TFS. You'd think this is a really easy thing, right? It's just, it's the categories that you put your work items and your bugs in. But again, what we were letting people do is, regardless of where you sat and worked in the organization, you could just make up whatever structures you want, you could root them and parent them wherever you wanted. And the number of root-level area paths we had in the 2008 product was terrifying. If you had to file a bug, or put a work item, or put a task in, you had to spend minutes just trying to figure out where to even get started. And I'm not going to lie to you, my trick back in the day was I would just put it somewhere. Because there is somebody who's responsible for that one, and now it's their problem. But that's really not very fair. It's, you know, passing the buck to somebody else. And I tried to get close, right? I'm like, well, it's sort of about tests, so here you go. And but that was clearly not good. And then as we got to 2010, some of us standardized. So I think in the ALM business, we standardized a bit, and that made the pile a little bit smaller. And then 2012 got a little bit better. And this year, in fact, it was about 6 months ago, 7 or 8 months ago, Aaron and I were involved in a working committee from across the entire division, and we got together. And we actually got everybody in the division to agree on a common area path structure. So now we've got everybody on a common sprint path, 1,000 people, and everybody on a common area path structure for the first time since we started doing Agile more than 5 years ago. It was challenging. It's hard to move a ship this big, but one little step at a time. Now when you go to look for where to put a work item, a task, or to find something about another team's work, it's easy. You know where to go. Because, in fact, the other thing we've learned, right, is that area path equals
team.
Team.
Absolutely.
That's just another one of those little things that we kind of figured out. You're finding this now more in the TFS guidance than you used to. But in fact, the best use for area path is team. Align it with team and so many problems go away. The TFS tooling starts to really encourage it with the way it does teaming now. And I think you're going to get into some of this more on your...
Yeah, in my talk tomorrow, we'll go into that a fair amount when we look at the new Agile portfolio management features.
But that is, again, something that we had to learn along the way. We used to sometimes break our iteration paths. Some teams would break them by component or by product group or by a mixed bag of the above or by, you know, in what product it shipped, which has not necessarily anything to do with how you build it or what teams build it. Because we're a big, broad organization. All of us contribute to lots of different products. So figuring that out was challenging, to say the least. All right, so what I want you to think about here then as we kind of close up on this section is to recognize that there are parts of your team's rules, parts of the game, the definition of the game, that the team should not have to spend any cycles thinking about. And this isn't about being a dictator and imposing things on them that they don't want to do. It's actually about freeing them from having to even worry about that stuff. You should be able to spend your time doing your job, and you shouldn't have to spend your time arguing or worrying or thinking about some of these things that are clearly shared. So for DevDiv, we're all working on the same product family, iteration path, area path, some of those kinds of things, where we check in and the rules for checking in and what the branches mean, common. And until we did that, we really struggled to be an Agile team that was as big as we are, but we're making headway now. So ask yourself, and as you think about your teams at work, especially those of you who raised your hand when I asked if you were multiple teams in a large organization, are all of the teams playing the same game? Are they playing on the same field with the same rules? Right? And if they're not, is that causing a problem that you just don't need to have? It helped us a lot to get rid of it. You should probably consider something similar.
I think, too, before we move on from that, I think, you know, take an approach. If you're somebody that's involved in putting those rules together for your team, like Peter mentioned, rules can be a really good thing. They help a team understand what the boundaries are so they can drive fast, if you will. But start with a less is more approach, and then hold your own set of retrospectives and figure out what's working and what's not. If you need to add things, you can add them. But I see too many teams come up with a playbook that, you know, it takes a year. You need like a PhD to understand it. And then you get yourself locked into all this garbage that you're doing, and nobody really understands why. And it's a lot harder to pull that stuff out than it is to add new stuff in. So think about that. Okay, so next topic. We're going to move on and talk about debt. So why are we talking about debt? Well, we're talking about debt because debt isn't a good thing. It's just something that we want to avoid. But in the world of software, it's something that we have to deal with. And I think, unfortunately, we oftentimes don't do a great job dealing with it. I really don't believe that there's a healthy software environment out there that has lots of debt built into it. And in this next section, after we sort of talk about some principles for debt, Peter's going to talk a little bit about maybe how to think about debt and how to manage it a little bit better, and share with you some of the ways we've done it in the past and the ways we've failed miserably at it. But I think you've got to get to a point where you can understand what your debt is and deal with it. And to go there, you first need to talk about what is debt. And the first and sort of most obvious one is when we think about writing software, bugs represent debt. So bugs represent defects in the software. They represent problems. We've written code, something's not working right, and it needs to be fixed. And if you let those things pile up, you'll soon end up in a place where you won't be able to get people to use your software because you've got so many problems with it and so much of that debt piled up. We've been there and we've lived it. So that's sort of the obvious one. But there's a couple more, maybe less obvious ones that I want to talk about. And the first is technical debt. We see this a lot in teams where they have aspirations to write unit tests, for example. And they're going to reach certain code coverage metrics. And they just don't. And they cut corners and they leave those things on the table. And they exit a sprint without doing it. And before you know it, they're two sprints down the road. And they've got these items on their backlog that say clean up technical debt. Okay, that's a bad place to be. It's an unhealthy place to be, and you really, really want to avoid it. So you need to talk to your teams and work with your teams about when you're making commitments around this type of stuff, you've got to follow through, and you've got to make sure that you're paying off that debt all the time. Once it accumulates, once you've got that credit card statement that is so big that all you're doing is making the minimum payment, you're sunk. You know, you really can't use that credit card anymore because, you know, you've used up all the credit that you had.
Hey, Aaron, if I can jump in here for just a second. To give you, a little historical point for how things have been for us in the past, when we look back at those older releases, 2008, 2010, and our early adoption path down this road, we very often used to introduce a thing we called MQ. Remember a good old MQ? MQ was the quality milestone. And strangely enough, we did it after we shipped you the product, right? So we would do MQ after RTM, and its express purpose was to clean up the technical debt that we had put in the product building it before we started on the next cycle. And the need to do that was just a clear indication of just deferring this technical debt down the road.
Yeah, and I think if you want a clear way to demotivate your team is ask them to work on technical debt for 3 months. It's a killer. Nobody wants to do it. The third one here is what I call never-ending backlogs. And as a product owner, this is one that's very easy for me to relate to. So I'm a PM. My role is program manager, but we often think of ourselves as product owners. And I often, you know, meet with customers and whatnot, and they say, well, can the product do X, Y, or Z? And my answer is, sure, it's on the backlog, right? That's an easy answer for me to give. I've put it on the backlog. Well, if the backlog is 5,000 items long, and I put it at the end of the backlog, I really didn't do anything. I just sort of appeased the customer, appeased the person making the request. And when we do that, what we tend to sort of defer a bunch of decision-making about whether or not we're really going to make a decision about something that we're going to do or not. And trust me, I can share with you real examples of this in the product, examples that I'm embarrassed about. How many of you would like to rename your team projects in TFS? Okay, I know it's comical, and
It's on the backlog, right?
It's on the backlog, I know, it is. Trust me, it is. But it kills me, and it's debt that we've let accumulate on the product, and I'm literally embarrassed to stand here in front of you and sort of be honest about that. But it is, and we've got to get that taken care of. Because once I do that once, I've got to start making trade-offs around, am I going to go back and do team project rename, which is going to be more and more expensive, or am I going to go do, you know, super sexy feature X that the marketing team wants so that we can sell more of the product. And now I'm stuck and I'm trapped. And you want to avoid this type of a situation. So it's not an easy problem to solve, but my encouragement to you is make decisions about what you're going to do and make decisions about what you're not going to do. Don't just blindly throw things on the backlog and let that backlog accumulate and accumulate. Once it's beyond sort of a reasonable measure of whether or not you can understand if you're going to do something in the next year or so, it's probably a little unwieldy, and it's probably not something that can really truly be managed. And guess what? You will spend time managing that backlog then as well, and it really results in more waste. So you got to take a hard and fast approach on some of this stuff. And then the final one is non-functional requirements. I think it's really, really easy to create debt problems around things that aren't specific features, but maybe are performance metrics that you need to meet. A common one for us is localization. We've got to localize the product. And there was a time when we used to always defer that and kick it down the road. We'd get to a point where we had to go in and pay our localization debt, and it was a killer. It was a killer to morale on the team and all kinds of things. So you've got to pay these non-functional requirements as you go and keep track of them. I want to share a brief story here. Back in the 2010 product cycle, we had teams that were finishing their milestones and declaring victory. But when you went and tried to install their features or run setup or upgrade on them, they would always fail. And it was just this problem over and over again. So you sort of had this, on one hand, you had people celebrating that they reached a goal. You know, we're done. It's the classic sort of done story. But we're done, and we've taken care of this. And then you go to try to use it or test it, and you can't. And it's littered with bugs, all this stuff right up front. And you go, well, you know, does setup work? Can I run install on it? Oh, well, we haven't gotten to that yet. You know, we haven't gotten to upgrade yet. Well, if you haven't gotten to upgrade, I can't use it. And so we had to really sit down with folks and decide, you know what? This setup and upgrade tax, if you will, we're paying it all the time. We're paying it every sprint. And nobody is going to be checking in garbage into the system anymore that can't pass that quality bar and can't do it. If I can't set up the product, you're not done. I can't use it. But again, in the heat of the moment, in the heat of planning, in the heat of everything else, it's very, very easy to keep kicking this stuff down the road further and further. Okay, so why do we bring this up? We bring this up because I like to think of it like this. We are sort of in the business of building something like this. This is just an example, but let's say we're building a cruise ship. A cruise ship belongs out on the open ocean. It belongs in a beautiful place with passengers on it enjoying themselves. That's its purpose. That's why we want to build it. But if we're piling up debt on our features, or our cruise ships, if you will, we end up with our cruise ships here. We end up with them stuck in dry dock. And we can't ship them when we need to ship them, and we can't let customers use them the way they want to use them, and quite frankly, we can't be learning from them when we need customers' feedback and things like that. So, you know, my encouragement to you is really to take a look at how much debt your teams are carrying, how much debt you're allowing them to carry, and make a plan to get it under control. I think as long as you've got debt problems, you really can't be a healthy, agile team. And I think once you get ahead of this, you really start to turn a corner in terms of an agile transformation.
So the funny thing about debt, and in particular technical debt and bugs, is that we, as engineers, right, we have a strong desire to measure and count things and build gates and checks and all this other kind of stuff. We like to be very quantitative about how we track and do the work that we do. And we often forget this little trick, right, that when you measure something, it does affect the outcome. It changes the behavior of the team. It changes everything. And you start to actually evolve processes and change your own methodology, your process of how you build the software, which in turn results and a change to the quality of the product or the product itself, just because you chose to measure something and to track it and to gate on it and to use it. So we've got these tools, and we've got all this wonderful stuff in TFS and Visual Studio that lets us do all this great things, and you got to be really careful about using it, and I guess that's really my point. So tell you just a little story again about how we were building Visual Studio before we kind of shortened our cycles down. So we had this construction phase, this coding phase, and we actually would end at a point in time that we called code complete. You know, you'll sometimes hear jokes in the Agile community about code complete, but we actually said it with all seriousness. And people felt good, like, I don't know why they did, but they somehow felt good when they would get to this code complete phase. But then, you know, you suddenly would realize that maybe there's some more we're going to have to do. Because we've spent all of this time coding and coding and coding and coding and not really fixing any bugs. So code some more and still don't fix any more bugs. Okay, good, code complete. Well, I guess that means what? I wrote a bunch of code and a bunch of bugs. We actually had cycles like this that were themselves as much as a year long. And this is just an insane way to build software. I'll tell you that. And I'm very glad we don't do it anymore. Because you spend all of that time getting to this so-called code complete phase, and all you've really been doing is kicking bugs further on down the road. So the thing I want to point out about bugs, and that's an actual bug chart from us from 2005 timeframe, I think, or 2008, halfway between, is that when bugs become the thing you track and measure as a way of keeping track of your project, and when you have a cycle like I was just describing, what happens is teams get really good at writing a giant pile of code and a giant pile of bugs. You get really good at writing, you write them, that's what you do. And now you go through this phase of trying to figure out how to deal with them, and this is gonna get us back to dead again, right? Everybody's heard that old thing of, right, you know, you remember when you were young, we'll all pretend we didn't do it, but we know somebody who did. When you were, you know, 25 years old and you realized that credit card they gave you when you checked into the dorms in college is totally maxed out and full, and the interest rate on it's terrible, so what do? You apply for a new credit card, and you transfer all the balance over to that one so that your rate goes down, but you still don't have to pay it now, right? You're still not paying. We're just going to keep deferring that debt. So this chart is an actual bug burndown chart from a number of years ago. And this is what I want to point out to you that's really kind of neat about this. Aaron explained this to me because I didn't realize exactly what I was seeing. So I'm going to get my little laser pointer out here. So you see this nice burn down? Looks like they're doing great, right? They're burning these down, burning. And it looks like they're going to be done right around 422, whatever that year is. And this is a four-month period. Wonderful. Look at that. They're actually going to get their bugs burned down nice and quick. But there's another line on here, and it's this purple one at the top. That purple one at the top is the total number of active bugs. So what is this then? Well, this is the total number of bugs in the current milestone period. So in other words, what they're doing is they're saying, I'm not going to pay that now. And by saying I'm going to pay it later, that counts as being done. Isn't that great? Look at that, we're done. That's okay, they're over there. Shh, don't look. Don't look, they're over there. We don't have to do those yet. We're going to do those later. But you just keep saying you're going to do them later, and that pile up there never goes away. And when we are measuring and tracking bugs and treating bugs like a currency, like a unit of value, then all that happens is we get really good at making them. We get really good at creating them. Zero tolerance for bugs and getting rid of this idea of tracking this metric and making this metric be the thing that you care about is one of the hardest things that we've been trying to overcome.
Yeah, I think one of the things, too, that I'll share here is that as we made a transition into a three-week milestone and trying to become Agile a few years ago, one of the first things that we saw was the leadership team said, well, what we want to do is we want to have four sprints, okay, so four three-week sprints, and then we want to have two sprints for just bug fixing. Okay, that's what we want to do. And so what happened? Well, what happened is we wanted teams to exit their sprints with low bug counts. But there was zero motivation to do that. Because everybody knew that at the end of the four sprint time period, everybody was going to turn their attention to bugs. And what actually happened is You had some teams that said, you know what, I'm going to do the right thing. I believe in this, and I'm going to pay my debt down as I go, and I'm not going to build new features unless I've got my debt under control, and they would do that. And so when we got to bug fixing time, and they were in good shape, guess what they were asked to go do? Did they get to go build new features? Nope. They got to load balance, which is a wonderful word to use in a team. It's a wonderful way to kill morale, is that you get to now go load balance, and you don't get to load balance a team on other good new features that are really important. You get to go help them clean up their mess and clean up their debt. And it just didn't work. And what was awesome about this, though, as an example, is that we actually had the teams talking to leadership and saying, you know what, you can't do this to us anymore. You can't keep these bug periods intact anymore. You've got to let go of them. And the leadership teams were the ones that wanted to hang on to them. They didn't believe that we could do it. But the teams were the one, out of their retrospectives and whatnot, actually pushing forward and saying, you've got to. Because until you do, you're not going to get the behavior that you want. You're just sort of setting us up to always be in this situation.
It took a while, but eventually we got everybody to kind of understand that the inclusion of that time window to do bug cleanup encourages you to fill it. Right? On one of my first jobs out of college, my manager said to me, you will always spend 5% more than your paycheck, so no, I won't give you a raise. And ultimately, it's the same idea, right? You're giving people a bucket in which to put stuff, right? That one right there. They're filling up this bucket up here because they know they're going to be allowed to use it later. And Aaron's absolutely right. I mean, we lost good people. We had teams break down. We had serious conflicts when people did get load balanced. It was a terrible morale killer. But eventually, we've now convinced people to stop this, and we're not doing that anymore. And that's led us now to be in a position to do what we're able to do, to ship these cumulative updates to the product, which are delivering new features continually throughout the release cycle, for the service to ship
every three weeks
updates, constant delivery of features to the service. And we would not have been able to do that if we were maintaining these giant bug pools like we used to do. So ask yourself now, what are you measuring at work, and what does that measurement actually produce? Does it produce great software that your customers want to buy, or does it produce something else? We learned how to produce bugs. We got really good at it. And then think about what perhaps you should be measuring instead. And let that drive your next little bit of thinking. So where are we going, Aaron?
Okay, so our final topic here actually is we're going to end by talking about the program manager or the product owner. And I have up there PM or PO, and I mean PM as in project manager or PO as in product owner. And I think one of the things that I've seen as I talk to customers and part of the software community is that we've got a lot of people going through what I would call sort of a career identity or a crisis in identity, and those people are the traditional project managers. In the Agile world, a project manager doesn't really know where to fit in. They want to say, well, I'll be the Scrum Master. That'll be my role. And it's like, really? You're going to run stand-up every day? Like, I need you to do a bit more than that, right? But we've seen this sort of influx of people where we need to shift our focus and shift our emphasis to thinking about how does a product owner show ownership over a product instead of a traditional project manager and what they care about. And I want to contrast a few things. And the reason I bring these up is that I think this role has a huge impact on your environment and your team's environment. So a project manager, the first thing that they traditionally care about is schedule. That's what they're signed up to do is number one is schedule. And this used to be the role that a program manager at Microsoft would play as well. The first thing you saw sort of in the job description is you own schedule. That was your job. We've shifted, and our program managers now, we say that they care more about the product. They're really product owners. They're not project managers. Now, are they responsible for schedule? Sure, they do some schedule stuff. We've got to understand what the schedule is. But first and foremost, they care about what we're building. And I often think about this in terms of a car. A product owner for a car cares about everything on the car. You care about what color it's painted on the outside. You care about how we're building the engine and how it's put together. You care about whether it's got four doors or two doors. You care about how it feels when you step on the accelerator. You care about all that stuff. And we need product owners who really care about the product in that way. I also want to give you an example here, which is that a project manager, typically we think about that person as overseeing the team, is that they're responsible for what the team's doing. They're overseeing, sort of in this overarching or overseeing role. But a product owner is really a part of the team. And I know many of you are probably familiar with the old story about the pig and the chicken, right? This became sort of famous again when the Agile community adopted it. And they said that team members are pigs, they're committed, you know, to the team, and product owners are chickens. And the analogy here is that if you have a pig and a chicken contributing to a meal, the pig is all in on that meal. Because to put bacon or ham on a plate, you've got to give up your life to do that, right? A chicken can just, you know, poop out an egg and away it goes, right? Good to go. Not really committed. Participating, but not really committed. And often people talk about a product owner as being a chicken. And I hated that. I think it's completely wrong. I think product owners have to be pigs. They have to be committed, and they have to be a part of that. And I think if you don't have product owners that are a part of your team and are participating in your team, you're kind of set up for a very unhealthy environment. So
yeah,
give us some examples, Peter.
There's a number of interesting things that can occur or that we've been experiencing as we've been moving into these shorter cycles and these shorter ship cycles, and when you start to think about the role the product owner can play and the influence on that. When we're now in this position of shipping software every 3 weeks or every quarter or every month, whatever the particular product is happening, you can find yourself in this situation where you're constantly feeling that pressure to be done and deliver, right? Which in the Agileistas will tell you is exactly the way you're supposed to finish at the end of every sprint. But we also all know that there's other things you have to do. Aaron was talking earlier about the debt in the form of non-functional requirements. Well, inside of Visual Studio, we actually are very, very passionate about things like performance and memory usage and stuff like that. We have massive suites of tests that'll make sure the product doesn't get slower and doesn't start to consume so much memory that it crashes on you. And if we were to take that work and defer it and not work on it constantly and at all points in time, then we would have to eat that at the end. Now, when you're doing these constant cycles like we're doing, it means we're constantly having to pay attention to this, and so you've always got the next deadline is close enough that you can see it, 4 or 5 sprints away. There it is. It's coming at you. So you're always under this pressure, feeling like you're going to start to fall into that death march mentality again. Now, if the product owner or the PM, whatever we want to call them, we're PMs, but whatever, if they have that mentality or if the team perceives them as the overseer type, well, then he's not going to feel like he has to be on their side in terms of kind of pushing back on what we can get done. He's going to be always asking for more. It's going to be Veruca Salt. Sorry, maybe that metaphor flew over everybody. I want a goose that lays golden eggs for Easter. I want it now. Right? Constantly, I want. I don't care that the deadline's coming. Get it in. Figure it out. Constantly under this pressure. But when you're a part of the team, you empathize with the team. You join up with the team. And we've been feeling this recently. This is something that we're currently trying to reconcile as we talk through how do we avoid that sense of always being in the presence of a death march. And the product owner being a part of the team, really being a part of it, is kind of one of those key elements that we're thinking we're going to have to address to try to make that, because we still got a couple places where it's not working.
Yeah, and like Peter said, we're struggling with this right now. This is, and the new cadence that we're in and delivering software more quickly, we're seeing that our teams are starting to feel this death march. But one of the real positives that I've seen come out of it is we're actually seeing our product owners step up and get out in front of the teams. And they're actually defending and sort of shielding the team from some of the arrows that might be coming from leadership or marketing who's saying more, more, more all the time. And the product owner saying, no, we can't. You know, we've got a problem here. We've accumulated a little bit of debt. And when you've got a product owner arguing to go back and clean up debt instead of add new features, that's a different mentality than I think we're used to. But I think it's a mentality we want because they're a part of the team. I'm going to give you a really tactical example of some of the changes that we're making in this place, but I hope it illustrates how big of a change that is. So you see that little picture up there. And that picture is one of the new rooms that our entire division is moving into in the next 3 weeks. So we, right now, we reside in a couple of buildings on campus at Microsoft, and all of those buildings are set up as offices. So we all have individual offices. If you have enough seniority, you have a window office. And if you have zero seniority, you might be doubled up, you know, so you might share an office with somebody. Well, in a couple of weeks, we're moving to a new building that has zero offices in it. There is not a single office. Every single space in that particular building is a team, our team rooms, every single one. And it's sort of this grand experiment, you know, from folks like myself, who I'm literally just like middle management. That's all I am, right? I'm going into a team room. My boss is going into a team room. My boss's boss is going into a team room. And all the way up to Soma, who's our vice president, he will have his own team room, if you will, where the folks that work for him sit in an open space together. And I tell you this not to advocate that team rooms are the best model for everything. I think they're great for teams, and I think they contribute to an awesome environment for teams to work in. But when we do this, and when we move into that, we're not going to have a team room of product owners. Our product owners are embedded inside their team's team room. They sit with their devs, they sit with their QA members, and they all sit together. They're not something separate. They're not a different role that, you know, comes in every once in a while. They're embedded right with that team. And that's a very, very tactical move that we're making. Because we know that our POs need to care about the product, and they need to be defending the team in that way. So I think we're excited about it. Maybe at Tech Ed next year, I'll let you know if it worked.
We'll have some more pictures.
Yeah, like I said, it is a grand experiment. So, you know, our question here is really, does your product owner sit in the room, you know, at a metaphorical level, or do they sit outside the room? And I would encourage you to make sure that your product owners are really embedded in a part of your teams and aren't this separate role. I often talk to customers and they say, well, we've got business analysts and we've got these project managers and we got this role and we got that role and they're split across four different teams and we don't. And I just say, you know, I don't think it'll work. I think if you want to do this right, I think you've got to have somebody that's going to own your backlog, own your feature set, own that customer experience, engage with customers, and do it all. And I think they've got to be embedded in your team and sit with them and be a part of that team every day.
So we're going to start to ramp it down here because we intentionally wanted to leave 10 minutes here at the end for you guys to ask us questions. We told you at the front that we were going to be transparent about the things that have worked for us and things that have failed, and I'm sure we've either prompted questions or there's things we didn't answer that you would like to know. How do you do this? How do you do that? And we're gonna be happy to answer them. There are mics up the middle. I wanted to say that before. I know sometimes people start to scamper out, so please stay and ask questions and listen to what we've got to say about the answers, because some of them could be very interesting. Now, if we ramp this up, so these are, Aaron and I looked back over this Agile transformation that we've been doing as we were building out this presentation, and we thought about the things that had been either some of the biggest blockers, the biggest challenges, the hardest things for us in our 1,000-person organization to adopt. We started, both of us, working very small, working with our crews and working in small orgs and starting to apply these principles. And the problems, most of them actually came as we expanded them out. And that was where it really got challenging. You know, at the Agile conference, year after year, one of the top topics is Enterprise Agile. And this is why. It is hard to figure out how to scale this stuff, and I don't think there's any pat answers. So instead, we tried to kind of whittle it down to some of the key things that we think you guys can take away from our experience and try to apply on your own, right? The fine-tuning of your process is a very important thing, and it's not really something that only happens in the small at the crew level. But even you can see our iteration lengths, our area paths, the way we communicate with management is constantly undergoing revision. This has been another one. Aaron talked about schedule before when he was talking about the project management versus product ownership, but tracking schedule and forecasting when things are going to happen and what's going to be done and what's not, these are still very legitimate things that your management needs to know. Your marketing team wants to know them. Everybody wants to understand that. And a lot of people kind of get the mistaken impression that an Agile project doesn't have any of that. But of course, you still do. It's just we invert it. Instead of it being, we create the schedule and whip the teams to achieve it, we forecast and talk about the future. And it's taken us this much time to even get to where we can have that kind of a conversation with our senior management, but we now do. That is now how we present the work we're doing, is via a forecasting mechanism as opposed to an alignment to the plan mechanism. So we're fine-tuning our processes constantly. We're far from done. Still a lot of stuff to do, and we're constantly learning as we go. But you can't ever stop, and you need to do that at all of the levels of your organization. And then the second one, of course, was this thing about playing the same game. This one took a lot of time and a lot of work. It sounds like a crazy thing, but you wouldn't believe some of the meetings that we had to suffer through just to get people to finally agree to do something as simple as the same iteration path, same iteration series, and the same area paths. It was crazy. But doing it set the ground rules for us actually to start interoperating and working together, and has enabled a level of collaboration between teams on the products that we had never been able to achieve before. Because our organizational boundaries and the differences in the way we worked simply made it impossible. You couldn't have a conversation even that would be productive about delivering product. Debt, of course, you know, you deal with it is really about the only thing. Don't postpone it. Don't defer it. Don't transfer it to somebody else. Take it on, make it your responsibility, and get it done. And acknowledge that there's a lot of debt beyond bugs. There's the technical debt, the non-functional stuff. You have to take care of those things. If they count and if they matter, then you actually have to do them. And you can't just choose not to, because if you do, it's going to eat you at the end, and you're going to end up with those big, long stabilization cycles like I had on that slide before. If you're going to measure and track things, make sure you measure and track against the outcome that you want, as opposed to something else or perhaps the outcome that you don't want. Ideally, we are all interested in producing a piece of software that makes our customers happy. If we're building internal line of business apps, we want them to be happy so that our department stays in business and so they can do their job better so the company makes more money. If you're selling a retail product or a service offering or anything like that, you're in the business of either making money or gathering customers or something like that. Make sure that the metrics you're tracking, the things you care about, the currency you use to drive your business is something that leads to that outcome and not to the outcome of debt deferment, big bug piles, and all those other funny things that people can do.
Well, I'll add on to that too, is I think pay attention to what you're measuring and really understand why you're measuring it. I know a lot of people that collect a lot of stats, and you ask them why, and they really don't have an answer. You know, it's just they're doing it. They just keep doing it because they've always done it. And I think it's really healthy to go back and look at those things and challenge them sometimes and say, why do we do this? And is it actually adding any value to the product or the process, or is it helping the team, or is it just this tax that we impose on people because we've always done it that way? So
Aaron and I used to show in talks like this our 2008 era bug form, which was, you know, the TFS work item template for bugs. And it had, what, 137 fields?
156 fields.
156 fields on the bug form. And we did some statistical analysis on it because we're math geeks and we like to do such things. And we discovered that, in fact, only, what, 10% of them got used on average, right? Only 10% of them had a usage rate of more than 20%.
Well, in the most popular fields, though, the kind of flip side of this is that the fields that we talked about taking fields away, the ones that people screamed about and said there's absolutely no way you can take this field away.
Had no use.
No.
No?
Custom 01 and custom 02, right? They were these generic fields, and it shows how kind of backwards we had it. And we used to make a joke because, you know, Peter talked about dumping a bug in an area path. We used to just go change, you know, what is this TCID thing? And nobody knew.
We just
put stuff in there to see if anything would happen. You know, is the sky going to fall? Or, like, you know.
But basically,
bugs
were the one thing that we were common about forever was bugs. And so what happened is every team who did go off the rails and come up with their own crazy way of doing process would just go and put a request in to get their fields added to the bug form. And it just grew and grew and grew. And so when we went back and did this big cleanup of area path and iteration path, we also stripped the work item form back to almost nothing for bugs and for user stories and for experiences and scenarios and the work item types that we use in our business. And initially, a lot of people freaked out. I mean, there was some yelling in some of those meetings. And they've discovered, in fact, they really weren't probably using them and they really didn't matter as much. The fun one, of course, is remaining work. That's always a fun one, right? Aaron loves remaining work.
Love it, yeah.
We've been having recent conversations on one of our MVP mailing lists about the idea of tracking remaining work. So measure what you want, or measure that which will get you the outcome that you want. And be very careful about measuring and tracking and targeting other things. They will possibly have unintended consequences. Be a great product owner, and if you're not in that role in your team, demand a great product owner. And the product owner has to be a part of your team. As a team member, as a developer, as a tester on a team, ask your product owner, why aren't you sitting with us? And I mean that in the metaphorical sense. Why aren't you part of our team? Be here. And if you are a product owner, are you doing what your team needs? Are you being present? Are you a part of the team? Do you advocate for them? Or do you advocate for the schedule? Because one is going to get you a different outcome than the other. And these are the things then that we have, probably the top five things that we have seen in the last 5 years that have been kind of dominant issues and challenges for us as we have been changing the environment inside a developer division to move to a more agile model. So I'm going to stop on this slide here. This is our contact information if you want to get in touch with us. There are microphones right up the middle. And Aaron and I would like to,
About 10 minutes.
We have about 10 minutes left. And so we would love to have some questions. I think I see somebody there. I can't really see through the spotlight, so you just have to speak up.
Yes. My company is currently...
Oh, there you go.
Sorry. Currently in the phase that you were describing where we're trying to figure out our area paths and our iterations. And it seems like there's two forces at work. One wants to decide one method and push it down, basically from two people. We have about 45 developers. And another method would be what you described of several different teams trying things out to see what works mm-hmm. before coming together. And I was wondering if you feel it's inevitable that you really need the hard work of trying different things, or whether you would recommend it doesn't matter what you pick, just pick something from the start.
So are you specifically interested in area path?
Area path.
Is that one of the biggest problems?
Well, area path, defining what an iteration means to us, mm-hmm. because we have basically different teams that work on different products.
Right.
And knowing whether we should try to make that consistent or not.
So I'll tell you that one of the things we've certainly discovered is that the top significant levels of your area path hierarchy should be about your teaming structures. Mm-hmm. And so we have them very, very closely aligned with the way our organization works, down to kind of the unit of the team and the crew. And then typically what they will do is within there, the team will then, they own the definition from there down, and so they will often define by the product or the feature that they work on. So in my organizational group, we named our teams after colors. So we have red, yellow, blue, and green. And we have the purple team, which is basically the management guys. And when a task needs to get done by us, it goes in that category. But each of those teams will typically have underneath, you know, it's slash VSALM, the blah, 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 green. Then they'll have feature areas listed underneath that. But it allows them to associate that entire area path with them as people, as a group of people. And that certainly, I mean, and it also aligns better in with the tooling, right? We have good tooling reasons to want that. You want to?
Yeah, no, I think that's fair. And I think we should maybe talk afterwards. I have a session tomorrow on sort of the new Agile portfolio management where we're going to go into more of this. And I'd love to sit down and chat with you about it. I guess my answer would be, don't just pick something. Okay, I think you need to put some thought into it. So
yeah.
I think you asked that. But, you know, figure out what's going to make life easiest for the team. I think that's the key, and that's where I always mm-hmm. go back to. You know, this team room thing that we're doing has nothing to do with, you know, what's easiest for management. It has to do with what's going to make our teams most effective. And I would start there, and if you can figure out amongst yourselves what's going to make the team most effective, I think that's the starting point for where I would go.
Yeah, team first.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thanks. I was wondering, you know, two things. You know, what do you guys measure, given that you're building a dev tool, an IDE? And then second, do you do some comparisons across your color teams to, I don't know, I don't mean make a competition, but to kind of evaluate if one team is underperforming, et cetera?
Yeah.
Why don't you take that second part last and take the first part first?
Yeah. So let me talk about what we measure. So we measure a lot of things. I think first we pay close attention to, we do measure bug debt and how much debt teams are accumulating at any given time. And we have this metric which we apply, and if a team reaches a certain level, then it's kind of well known that if you reach what we call our bug cap, that you're not going to work on new features anymore. You're going to go make the right decisions about what you need to do to get that under control.
And we don't let you punt them up to the purple line anymore either.
Yeah, and that number right now is 4 bugs per engineer. And I'll talk a little bit about this maybe tomorrow in my talk, but teams are typically around the size of 10 people, and that would include dev and QA. And together we call those all engineers. So you think that a team can carry a debt load of about 40 bugs before they've sort of crossed the cap and gotten themselves into trouble. And that's one thing that we measure.
Well, I have to counter you real quick. My team's 10.
There you go. So it's different.
Any more than 10, and we start to get nervous that they're falling behind, and they need to catch back up.
Now, I think other things that we measure are, we've done a lot of experimentation over the last probably year, and I think our service has really helped us do this, with what we commonly call build, measure, learn. And we are tracking a ton of statistics around how real customers are using the product, and we go look for trends, and we look for what's pushing things up or down, and is a particular feature getting a lot of use or a little bit of use. And we're trying to use that to drive investment levels in where we're going next. So that's definitely another thing that we track. And then I would say a final thing that we track is we pay attention to whether or not teams are finishing what they start. I don't track burn down charts. I don't care about burn down charts. All my teams use burn down charts, but that is something for them. It's a tool for them to finish a sprint and finish their commitment. It's not a tool for me or anybody else to, point out that they're behind, or ahead, and then ask them what they're going to do about it. They're self-organizing teams, and they can do that on their own. So we don't track, burn down charts across all our teams. What we track is, hey, we said that when we started the sprint, we had these 8 things that we wanted to get done, and only 7 of them got done. And it's not a bad thing if only 7 of them got done. I understand that things happen, and you can't predict every step in a sprint. There's going to be mistakes made. There's going to be things pop up that you're going to learn that you didn't know, and that's okay. But what we sort of reward is that transparency. Now let me take the second part. If I've got a team that is every sprint saying we're going to get 10 things done and only getting 4 done repeatedly, we're going to start to dig in and talk about what's up.
I'm just going to tell them to stop predicting 10.
Yeah, right.
Start predicting 4.
Their eyes are a little bigger than their stomach.
Yeah.
But one of the things, I'll talk about this tomorrow in my talk on the Agile Portfolio Management, where I'll share a little bit more about our practices, is every other sprint we have a check-in. Peter's team does it every sprint, where we sit down with leadership and we just talk about how the team's doing. And those are opportunities to have, transparent conversations about, is the team healthy? Are we feeling good about it? Are we, this or that? But I don't do a lot of, Peter brought up remaining work. I don't track completed work and remaining work and then divide it by story points and by dev and get some magic number that tells me whether or not my team's healthy. I just go to them and ask, and I'm like, how are you guys doing? Are we feeling good or are we feeling bad? And we're a little less mechanical maybe than you might think. So
a couple of other things I just want to throw on there that we use as a tracking mechanism, because as I said before, it is totally acceptable for management and for the marketing team and sales and those kinds of people to ask, when am I going to get this? So there's a couple things we do to assist with that. One of them is we work on it's not a metric, it's not a quantifiable, it's a qualifiable, it's a thing we call CEV, which is basically a customer experience value. And we have dedicated teams, test teams, who go off and effectively pretend to be you. And they use the product from front to back on a real code base, and they write down where it hurt, and they wrote down where it felt good, and then we get together and we talk about it. And we use that to make decisions about, when is it good enough? When have we achieved enough investment into this feature area to say, all right, good. Because as we all know, I can keep going forever if you let me. So we can't just say keep going forever. So we have to keep going until it's good enough. And that's one of the aspects. And then the other one is this idea of forecasting. And forecasting is something that we ask our teams to do. And in order for them to forecast, they may choose to use a burndown chart in order to make a determination of their velocity. And they may then choose to do some estimation against the remaining work that they think is important to get to that CEV score. And then they tell me, we're going to finish that feature block of work in approximately two more sprints. And then, of course, the next sprint, we ask, how's it going? Should be only one now, right? And if it's more than one or less than one, there's interesting conversations to have about that. Maybe they tested it out with some customers and discovered that, in fact, the definition of that CEV wasn't high enough. It needed to be more, so we had to add more work to achieve a sellable product. Or maybe they ran into a technical hurdle that they had not anticipated that totally shut them down. These are reasonable. They happen, right? We can try to beat them up and say your velocity is too low, but that's not going to actually get us more product out of them. So the best thing is to kind of take this qualifying look instead of a quantifying look and to have the conversations that are necessary. So like I said, we track a customer value and then a forecasting approach. So that's kind of what we do. We don't compare across. I don't compare across teams. I don't do that game. We occasionally know that we have teams who perform less than others. Oftentimes that's actually from a management perspective a bit of a load balancing problem. Because we know that some devs are really fast and some are a little more slow and careful, and some teams will finish faster than others. And in fact, what we try to do when we find that situation is to move people around a little bit and try to make the teams a little more evenly balanced. That's worked out really well for us.
Yeah, it can often be a chemistry problem as well. Mm-hmm. I'll talk more about this tomorrow, but we leave our teams together for a long period of time. Our teams have existed in their current form for the last year about mm-hmm. now, and we're not going to change that. So we're not rebuilding teams every three sprints. These are teams that live together for long periods of time, so they can get really good at something and learn to work together.
Yep. So. Is there anybody else? I can't really see. The spotlights are really bright. Nope. Okay, well, it says we have 8 seconds left, so we are right on time. So thank you guys very much. Enjoy the rest of the conference. And please do come visit us at the drill-in, the deep dive talks. Remember, we're going to be drilling into a lot of those new features that you saw at the keynote this morning.